Welcome to the NoPo podcast, your home for non-political news, with your hosts, NoPo founder Vera Gibbons and media commentator Mitch Roschelle. NoPo, news without the noise.
Welcome everyone to the NoPo podcast. I'm Vera Gibbons and I'm joined by my co-host Mitch Roschelle and John Iannuzzi. Every week, we scour the internet looking for the best mix of non-political news headlines. We figure you have enough of the political stuff everywhere you turn. You're not getting much else when you put the TV on. You're just being bombarded with bias and angles, and it's opinion news. So we couldn't take it anymore, so we launched the NoPo podcast. And if you have found us here, it's probably because you can't take it anymore either. To which we say, thank you. And welcome, everyone. I'm coming to you from NoPo headquarters in Palm Beach. I like to say it's NoPo headquarters. It's not really. But we are coming off a bit of a cold front. So I've been just hanging out in my apartment, binge watching The Queen's Gambit. I love it. I'm very late to The Queen's Gambit party. But I binge watched the entire 7 episodes. It's that good. And I know my co-hosts, Mitch and John, have sort of poo-pooed it, or Mitch has.
No,
you don't think it's your thing, but I want to say, watch it. You're going to love it. 62 million households have actually watched it, and everybody loves it. You gotta watch it.
Well, let's just fix that math, Vera. It's 62 million in one household, because I was talked into it. And if you recall, maybe episode 3, when we first talked about The Queen's Gambit, I was saying no to it because I thought it had something to do with British royalty. Then when I heard it had something to do with chess, I was like, oh, definitely not, because I don't do chess. We had dinner with friends who said to me, it's really good, you got to watch it, and it has nothing to do with chess. So that night, Debbie and I watched the first episode, and we found ourselves watching all three of the whatever there are. We watched three until like 2 o'clock in the morning. And I still can't figure out why these friends who we had dinner with said it had nothing to do with chess, because the entire thing is about chess. But it's really, really good. It's really well acted. And I really encourage everybody to watch it if they haven't.
Yes, it is escapism at its finest. I came home from a dinner and I wrapped up the series. Same thing. I was watching it probably till 2 o'clock in the morning. John, have you seen it?
What was described to me, someone described it as sexy chess. So I was like, I'm out. But yeah. My wife keeps hovering over it on Netflix, that and The Crown. And then I just leave the room.
Well, I'm worried about The Crown because, first of all, I think the British royal family put a warning label on The Crown. It's several seasons and there's more to come, which seems like a tremendous investment in my precious time. But we watched The Undoing. I'm trying to remember what that was on.
HBO.
It was on HBO. And I thought that was really, really good, but that went fast. And now we just started on HBO Max, The Flight Attendant, I think it's called. And that's pretty good. Basically, if you're listening and you don't know us, you've realized that we have no lives. I think that's the conclusion that you just came to.
Nobody does, Mitch. I mean, nobody does right now. It's just, John, I mean, the fact that Merriam-Webster's word of the year is pandemic says it all. Did you guys see that?
Yeah, I did. And I thought it would be interesting for us to think about what our own word of the year would be. What would
family.
Your word be?
I'd say family or grateful. How about you?
Johnny?
I don't think I've ever used the word virtual as much as I have in the last 8 months.
Yeah.
Virtual.
I'm gonna go with a proper noun, so it maybe doesn't count, but I'm just gonna say Fauci because I just like saying it.
Wait, where's the bell? I gotta find the bell.
Is that political for me to say Fauci?
Oh, so close.
But just in full disclosure, the man's worked with multiple administrations on both sides of the aisle, so he's arguably apolitical, but there may be a bell.
The name definitely will elicit response. I mean, yeah. Sit around a you can't sit around a table, but sit around a Zoom and bring up the name. And
well, I just wanted to take a break from the action to read a review because we got another one, and it's another 5-star review. It's short. It's from G. Miller. I'm not going to disclose whether or not I may be related through marriage to G. Miller. I can't confirm or deny that. But he wrote, excellent new podcast. What a great podcast. Very entertaining. And I really like Mitch Roschelle. Have watched him for years on Fox. I don't know. I'm just saying the guy could be related to me through marriage, just possibly. But thank you, G. Miller, for that lovely review.
When are we talking ice cream?
I'm talking ice cream right now, Johnny. Good thing you read the show notes. I like your level of preparation. It's world class. So, Vera, apparently, if I'm not mistaken, we've sort of gone back to the future, and vanilla is everybody's favorite ice cream. Is that, did I get that right?
You are correct. That's according to Haagen-Dazs. This has been the case, I guess, for a couple of years, or for a while, probably more than a couple of years. But because it pairs so well with everything, pies and this and that. But it just goes to show we are pretty boring people here. But I will say, speaking from personal experience, vanilla Haagen-Dazs is actually hard to find at supermarkets in Massachusetts, anywhere where I spent the summer. I was finding plenty of vanilla bean, but not just plain vanilla. And you can't find vanilla Haagen-Dazs in the quart size, just the little pint size. So I found I was going to Walgreens to get the quart size Haagen-Dazs vanilla ice cream to go with my brother's homemade brownies.
Can I date myself? I remember when Haagen-Dazs was a thing, and this is in the early 80s, and you would eat it by the pint. There was the unit of measure was a pint, even if the back of it says serving of for four, that's just a lie. And I would go to the bodega on the corner of 2nd Avenue and 83rd Street in Manhattan, and it was $5 for a pint of Haagen-Dazs in 1983, 84, something like that. I think adjusted for inflation, that's like $2 million today. But what's Haagen-Dazs go for a pint now? I have no idea. I'm more of a buy ice cream out person than in a supermarket.
I only buy them when they're on special at Walgreens. So it's like two for $7 or something. But otherwise, yeah. It's up there. It's like maybe $8, $7.99 a pint, if I had to guess.
Wow. All right. Yeah. So, John, what's your... John, you don't eat ice cream. Ooh, that's another vegan.
Hold on.
Wait.
I am very happy to announce that the non-dairy options have quadrupled over the last few years. And now... we have just as many options as you guys do. There's a ton of.
Is there a brand that is mainstream in non-dairy frozen desserts? Because you can't call them ice cream.
I don't know if it's mainstream. Tofutti, which has a great cream cheese substitute. They have really good ice cream. But our freezer is filled with different couple of different ones. Some are not so good. Oh, Ben & Jerry's just came out with like three or four different flavors.
That makes sense to me. I'll keep it with the non-political theme, and I won't comment on Ben & Jerry's.
Yeah,
That's fine. So Vera, is vanilla your favorite?
No, I like chocolate chip cookie dough, Haagen-Dazs. Nice. Haagen-Dazs only. Like I'm not really a Ben & Jerry's person per se, and I was for a while doing the, is it Halo? The ones that you can eat the entire pint for like 100 calories. I was doing that for a while, sort of off of that now. I'm basically off of the ice cream. I mean, I don't know. Like, I know everyone's been doing comfort food during the pandemic. Yeah. I've been doing like comfort alcohol.
Is that red or white or brown?
All white. I just picked up a case at ABC Liquor the other day. In fact, I'm now a frequent buyer at ABC Liquor in Palm Beach, so I got myself a case of Chardonnay. I'm all set there for a while now.
I like how the unit of measure is a case. I talked about 1983 it being a pint of ice cream, and now fast forward to adult years, and Vera's bringing it down by the case. The next step up would be palate. So when you end up having the delivery of a palate of wine, then you know it's time to check yourself into a program. Well, speaking of deliveries, it seems that UPS and FedEx are already overwhelmed. If you go online and order something from Amazon Prime, that next day, same day is a thing of the past. And they've now pushed you order on Monday. It says expect it on Thursday. And this is only the beginning of December. So I think it sort of harkens back to the beginning of the Webster's number one word for the year pandemic, that people are going to have to wait quite a while for their packages to come.
Yes, it's just people are spending like drunken sailors. So the online sales, I saw the estimate, I think it was the latest one from Adobe or some other such, accounting for close to $200 billion of total holiday sales. You know, it's just people doing it from the comfort of their homes. And the downside, Mitch, would be like, okay, the websites are crashing. There's all these various outages. And I'm sure you heard the story about Peloton having a problem getting bikes into customers' homes. And they've been delayed for months. They can't seem to get it together. So people are spending thousands of dollars, all anticipation of getting their bike into their living room. And they've been changing the dates on the customers without much notice. And people are pretty fed up. I mean, it's, you'll see them on Twitter and some of these other platforms expressing their anger that they don't have their bikes.
You know, what's interesting, and it's not just Peloton, because there's multiple entrants into that space. There's the Nordic Track brand, there's Ekdelon. I mean, they're not alone. It used to be that it was just Peloton. So you would think that with new entrants into the space and not a lot of barriers to entry, you'd find that they would be able to fulfill the orders. But the fact of the matter is their supply chain is as molasses-like as everybody else's, and they just can't satisfy the customers. And I wonder at what point does it hurt their brand, though? Because Peloton's all about their brand.
Mm-hmm. And the people who buy Pelotons are all about, I mean, it's like a status symbol purchase. So I don't think that people will shift and buy the new Nautilus bike or some of the competitive bikes that are out there. It's like people just want to have a Peloton in their living room just because. Certain people do anyway. That's my take. John, do you have a take on that?
I wonder how large did they think they would get, and how was the infrastructure not in place? Do they not have enough bikes, or is it just the delivery of the bikes? How could they have prepared for this, I guess?
Well, from what I understand, and forgive the potential condescending read on what I'm about to say, but I don't think any business in February expected the entire country to be shut down. And so Peloton's one of the winners. Like, what's the first thing we did? Your gym got closed. You bought a home gym. So it's not just Peloton. It's the Mirror people. It's the Nordic Tracks. It's just a regular old treadmill. You can't get any of those things. I'll give you another example, which is you can't buy one of those outdoor propane-based heaters for your deck at home, or because the restaurants are all gobbling them up like crazy. So I think that it's really unfair to criticize businesses for having not planned, because no one could have anticipated the demand for certain products. Like, nobody could have anticipated that. And that's a trend that will likely continue. We come out of this thing, I think businesses are going to reimagine their entire supply chain and figure out how to source things more locally. And potentially that can be delivered more quickly. Think about the automobile industry. Drive by I think we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, drive by a car dealership, you will see pavement in their lot as opposed to cars. They can't get them. They literally, because we shut down domestic manufacturing of cars for about a 6-week period. So
there's an appliance store locally here in Connecticut, and the guy has the issue of not being able to get these appliances out. He's overwhelmed with them. He's got plenty of them. There's no pavement there. He just can't get them. He can't get them out. There's not enough trucks going out.
It's a common phenomenon. It seems antithetical to what's going on with the economy that there would be such outsized demand for certain products and an inability to find the people to make them and manufacture them. But it's just that we've shifted everything towards, it's almost like a seesaw, you know, like when there's two people of like weight on a seesaw, there's balance. But when somebody jumps off, the other person goes flying, you know, and that's really what's happened. And I said seesaw, I don't know if you're a teeter totter person, but growing up where I did, we called it a seesaw. You probably have some fancy Palm Beach name for it.
Seesaw. I mean, I would imagine people are back doing seesaw now out in the backyard where they're doing everything else. They're grilling, the fire pits.
And the trampolines. Everybody in my neighborhood, largely with girls, have installed trampolines. And you can see the kids. One of our neighbors installed it. And, you know, you have to put the fence around it. And I said to Debbie when we were walking Charlie the other day, I said, I may just have to stand here and watch because it's inevitable the girl's going to go flying over the side of the thing. Well, this is a complete non sequitur to people flying off of trampolines, but what's flying off of the shelf, if you will, at McDonald's, and we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, maybe they were listening, but the cult favorite, the McRib, is back, baby. If you're not familiar with the McRib, it is a boneless pork sandwich, barbecue flavor, that is made up of 28 ingredients. And as Vera notes in the notes, most of those are probably names we can't pronounce. It's partially hydrogenated something in there, but
I'll give you an example. Potassium sorbate, polysorbate 80, diglycerides, monoglycerides, calcium chloride. Any of those sound familiar, Mitch? I mean, they always say,
well, first of all, I like the, you said it was whatever number 80. I think 79 would have been a better pick for that.
You're not supposed to eat anything or put anything in your body if you don't recognize everything on the ingredient list. This one has 28 ingredients, as you mentioned. These are some of them. And then you've got extraordinary amounts of sodium, sugar, and saturated fat. So I know that this is a cult favorite, and I know people will go and buy the McRib. And I'm just saying, doesn't sound like it's the healthiest option, Mitch.
Could care less about healthy. I know I'm going to hit that thing hard because it's, you know, it's while supplies last. You got it. It's like the Shamrock Shake at Mickey D's. You know, it's for a limited time, so you don't want to squander those Shamrock Shake. And by John, I'm relatively sure there's actually no milk products in the Shamrock Shake. You could probably eat it if you weren't like so healthy.
There are, you know, those pine cone air fresheners.
Yes.
Some of the ingredients that you just listed are in those. Think about that.
All right, that's fine. I'm almost 60 and I'm still kicking, dude. So you know, you can hate the player, but don't hate the game. All right. I think I got that.
Where do I sign? I want to be in your condition when I'm your age.
All right. Well, speaking of games, as we transition to our guest for this week. A game that we've been talking a lot about on the NoPo podcast is golf, because we are stuck indoors and we were actually able to go out and do something without a mask on. I believe maybe on episode 2, when we were chit-chatting at the top of the show, I remarked that I just got back from a lousy round of golf, and I didn't realize that that comment would get a lot of people's attention, because I think they all empathize with going out. And I believe I said a bad day of golf is still better than a good day of being locked in your house with absolutely nothing to do watching Wheel of Fortune. So that compelled me to think about guests from the golf world. So I reached out to one of my favorite Instagram follows, Tisha Alyn, who has a awesome social media empire that's only growing. She would probably fall into the category, which she can talk more about, of being an influencer. She certainly influenced me, although she's a full-time ambassador for Cobra, Puma, and AT&T. I am an AT&T customer. I just bought new irons, Tisha. Sorry, they're Callaways, so don't hate me. She's also has partnerships with Top Golf, MasterCard, the USGA, and more. And she is a host of various golf programs on TV, radio, and more. And without any further ado, Tisha Alyn, welcome to the NoPo podcast.
Thanks so much for having me. This is so exciting.
Well, so you're in beautiful, sunny California. We're trapped on the East Coast, although Vera is in Palm Beach. So that is better than what we're dealing with in the Northeast. So how's it in California? And have you seen the same thing we've observed, which is the golf world is on fire? And could we count the number of new followers you have on various social media platforms as a way to measure how hot golf is?
I'm not sure if you can use my social media following to measure that. However, I can attest to golf growing. I have had numerous DMs, at least, from actually just a plethora of different people, just young girls, random guys saying like, yeah, I want to get into golf. Where do I get clubs? And I think it's awesome. I think if anything, this pandemic has basically brought in a ton of new golfers, and especially here, and I'm based in Southern California. the weather's pretty good all year round. So golf is just happening basically nonstop. Although I think today we started a lockdown again. So I'm not sure if they're going to close golf courses as of yet. I know some courses closed in the LA area since numbers are spiking over there, but as of right now, they're not. But hopefully golf will be the one thing standing through the next 3 weeks leading up to the holidays. It's such a popular thing to do, especially right before Christmas. So,
And I want to get into your social media game, which I admire greatly, but with being in Southern California, where golf was sort of everywhere all the time, in sort of the post-Tiger Woods era, we saw golf sort of nationally become sort of less popular as measured by TV ratings and even equipment sales and stuff. But was golf still sort of hot in Southern California and it just heated up more? Or did golf in the nicest weather place, you live close to San Diego, which is the greatest weather in America, did golf cool off there too? Or has golf just even picked up from a pretty strong base to begin with?
I feel like golf has been pretty strong and then through this time has just gotten stronger, honestly. I mean, for me, you know, it's funny because growing up, you know, golf really wasn't looked at. And I was born and raised in Illinois. So being a young competitive golfer at the time, I started when I was three, started competing at seven. It was something I was always teased about, you know, like golf was not cool. Golf was like literally not even the sport to look at in school. There was never even a team for you in middle school or whatever. Moved over to California more towards high school. And even then it was like, golf is not considered a sport. Why do you have a Letterman's jacket? Blah, blah, blah. And then me coming out of college, it just became like this booming effect. I think there was just a huge spike in like, kind of like that college atmosphere, like, you know, fraternity boys and stuff like that started really getting into the game. Platforms like Barstool Sports really started bringing more golf, making it like that bro vibe. And then social media bubble hit, which is when I was in it, when I turned pro, more girls were showing themselves on social media, starts booming again. And then now we're in a pandemic and it's like, well, the only thing you can do is golf. I want to be outside. I'm going nuts being indoors. So let's go just try and figure it out. Let's put this aggro energy of being indoors into this golf ball and like go from there.
Do you think, Tisha, that the love of golf and the new people getting into the game, will this trend continue after the pandemic? Is this something that will stick, or are people just trying it for the first time and doing it because of the pandemic, and might it not, maybe they don't love it as much as we think? I don't know.
No, I think that, you know, when you catch the golf bug, it's like real. It's like a real thing. Like when you can, it's like something about hitting that one solid shot that you're like, oh my gosh, that was awesome. Now I'm going to sit here for another 2 hours to try it again. And I think that like when you catch the golf bug and like people who have caught it, you just can't really explain it. It's just, it literally becomes an addiction that people will just literally keep buying equipment and keep going. And I think I just picture it thriving even after this, even more so, which is exciting for me.
And one of the brands that you're have a partnership with is Topgolf, which to me, if you're not familiar with it, it's like take bowling, alcohol and golf and merge them together and do it at night.
Yeah.
But has Topgolf's, you know, seen the level of interest that people have, because it's outdoors, but it's, you know, it's more of a sort of semi-outdoor thing because it's sort of an indoor-outdoor thing. Has Topgolf been as hot as, you know, just walking a fairway for 4 hours?
Oh, absolutely. I think I'm such a huge advocate for Topgolf, even before I ever started working with them, just because, you know, golf can be a bit intimidating to get into, especially for women. And it's just like, it feels like such a huge commitment to, oh, I got to get clubs. Oh, I got to go out there. Oh, I might be in a stuffy place. I don't want anyone to approach me and teach me how to golf. But like Topgolf, it's like that one place, just like you said, like bowling, it's just like a great way to intro someone into golf. Like, hey, here's a drink. Hey, there's clubs right there. Like, give it a swing. It doesn't matter. Like, there's literally everybody around you is topping it. So like, what's the worst that can happen? Like, there's no afraid of you. Like, you're not going to be a fool over there. It's literally just pure fun. And I honestly think Topgolf alone, just that industry, that company has brought so much newcomers into the game.
And if you get bored and you're on your smartphone, oh, by the way, complete digression, but we talked about phones. I got myself the 12, gang. Got nice. Myself the iPhone 12. This is like the super duper max in a moment of complete boredom. But AT&T had a sweet deal. But in any event, if you go on Instagram and you go on Reels, which if you're not familiar with that, that's sort of Instagram's version of TikTok. And there are, in fact, sort of repurposed TikTok videos. And we will plug your TikTok in a second, Tisha. But there are some awesome golf fails in there. And the algorithm must be smart because it knows the kind of things that I look for. So I look for, you know, golf fails and people catching big game fish, because that seems to be what's in my feed. But there are some great top golf fails where people literally top the ball and like hits them back in the face and stuff. Yeah. Like things you couldn't do 100. But what I want to figure out, and Tisha, maybe you can answer this. Mm-hmm. Some of these trick shot moves, which you also do some trick shot stuff, and some of your friends in the golf world do it too.
Yeah.
But when they have two balls that hit each other in the air, like that, and I see them in these top golf videos, like that is insane. I've only had it happen once to me in a golf match, and we had to like literally empty out the pro shop of every human being to come figure out what the ruling was, because my partner and I both chipped onto the green at the same time and the balls landed incredibly close to the hole. And of course our opponents wanted to disqualify us, but in any event, but I see that in these videos, I'm like, how in the world, what are the odds of two golf balls intentionally colliding in the air?
Oh, it's definitely not easy. No matter what people say, that takes multiple attempts, any trick shot for that matter, you know, it's always going to take attempts, even just the setup of making sure that you capture the shot properly on video, or you can capture the shot and then it won't look clear or whatnot. Yeah, I definitely am friends with basically all the trick shotters in golf, a few outside of golf. And so I know what that kind of stuff takes. I haven't even attempted that shot. I just think it's too much effort. So you probably won't be seeing that in my Reel or TikTok feed anytime soon.
Well, speaking of your Reels and your social media game, and I do want to talk to you about that before we let you go. So you can find Tisha at Tisha Alyn, and it's Alyn on Instagram. On Twitter, she's at Tisha_Alyn. TikTok, she's Tisha_Alyn. And on YouTube, she's just Tisha Alyn. So she's everywhere in social media. But tell me about being an influencer, because that is really something that we find fascinating. The fact that there's this entire industry of folks that are influencers, and how much pressure is it to continue to have content out there? Because, you know, once I get past a stupid selfie, I'm done. I've got nothing else. That's the extent of my game, and pictures of my dog. You know, like there's nothing else. I got nothing. So how hard is it to constantly be curating a playlist, if you will, of content for your followers?
You know, it's definitely not for everybody. You have to have like a creative mindset literally every day. And like, no question, there's burnout and whatnot, but I think just because I love golf so much, I feel like just ideas will come to me randomly. And it's like this never ending thing. Like I literally will go to bed and just be like, oh my gosh, I could have shot this better. Or, oh my goodness, I could do this trick. Or, oh my gosh, let's do this skit. Like you literally never stop. But it's like the word influencer wasn't even a thing when coming out of college. You know, it's not like I got my communications broadcast journalism degree and I was like, I am going to be an influencer. That is my, like, that was never a thing. It didn't exist. We didn't even know what to call it when it hit the golf world. We were like, are you doing the social media thing? Are you an IG golf girl? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't know if I even like the name of that. Are you a golf babe? I'm like, I don't think I like the name of that either. Like, and for me, becoming an influencer, I was really just using social media as a means of building my professional golf career. I just wanted more eyes on my game. I wanted to find a way to get more attention from sponsors and clothing and club companies, et cetera. And then I just started to do some creative ideas, fun edits, fun tricks, fun dances, whatever. And that's how it just kind of blew up for me. And that was end of 2015. And then fast forward to 2018, I put the bag down like competitively, still am professional, but haven't competed since then. And I just wanted to get more creative. And that's kind of where I found the love for quote unquote influencing. It became more of a word in 2018, but like, you know, you just never stop. And at least there's different platforms. So it's like, I'm kind of over TikTok right now. I have no idea. It's like, all right, let's just do a YouTube. Let's just like sit and talk to the camera, or like, you know what? Like, let's just create a fun photo or a fun atmosphere on Instagram. Like, there's always something to change it up so that you're never too tired of one thing.
And Tisha, are you doing all these posts yourself? I'm just on your Instagram account now. By the way, for people listening, Tisha is beautiful, drop dead gorgeous. And that you. Helps, I'm sure.
Thank you.
189,000 followers, you know, I mean, I can't imagine more than, I mean, I'm thinking like 80% or 90% are men because you are so pretty. But anyway, are you doing all these posts yourself? Or are you yeah. Do you have like an intern helping you?
No, oh my goodness, I wish. So I do have the help I do have is I have someone that helps edit the YouTube videos because long form content is just so hard to like, you can sit and edit those for like hours. And like, if my mind is never stopping and I want to create something, I don't have time to sit and edit these YouTubes. But like, that's the hard thing that people I think don't realize about being an influencer is that you are your own director. You come up with the act, you come up with like the cast, you come up with literally everything. And I think that's the difference between just an influencer who maybe per se just posts pretty photos and someone who's a content creator. Like a content creator is literally the one who knows where to put the camera, who knows how to act the part, who knows how to produce it, who can edit it, deliver it, caption it, do it again and not be tired of it. You know, so I would like to say I'm more of like a content creator in the golf space because I think there's just more dynamic. You know, it's not just that photo smiling. I mean, I can do that occasionally. Like that's cool. I'll do photo shoots and whatnot. I love it. But like creating is like really where I feel like, oh, I loved what I did. Like that's cool. I hope other people love it too.
Beauty and brains, both.
Thank you.
The one thing, and I'll just give you some big brotherly advice as you transition also into doing TV,
yeah.
The difference between TV and your world where you're the actor, producer, director, everything on TV, you have a little plastic wire that's stuck in your ear and you have somebody screaming at you. So
I know I've experienced that for sure. And that's like one thing that people do not realize is a talent in itself to speak calmly and, you know, be very clear with your words while a producer is yelling at you that you have like 0.5 seconds left. Please pass it.
Well, one of the things they often scream in your ear is rap. And unfortunately, that's sort of where we are in this week's NoPo podcast. One thing I will say about Tisha, and it's nice to meet you in person because I've been following your Instagram game probably since around 2018, is I literally feel like I know you from there because I see you all the time. You're literally in my phone. And yes. I feel like I know your entire family. And if you follow her, you will realize, in addition to the brains and beauty that Vera referenced, is she's an amazing dancer. I cannot dance a lick, but she can do that also. So not only she can bounce a golf ball on the face of a wedge until her arm gets tired. She could, you know, doesn't miss a fairway, but she can dance. And and by the way, when I got my hole in one this summer, which I've shared with the audience, not only did I not see it, but I didn't do some stupid idiotic dance. and this is, Johnny, you can cut this out. But literally, I was playing in a match and my opponent hit the ball on a par three, obviously, to about a foot and a half. And we were down 5 in a 9-hole match on the 8th hole. So you know how bad that was. And the only thing I could do was get a hole in one. It was the most anticlimactic thing that, like, we were down 5, I got a hole in one, and I didn't do the stupid Snoopy dance, but that whole story will be cut out of the show. In any way, Tisha, thanks so much for joining us. I'll give you all the places you can find her. If you haven't found her already, you can find Tisha Alyn on Instagram at Tisha Alyn, it's Alyn, and on Twitter at Tisha _Alyn, on TikTok, Tisha _Alyn, and then just type in Tisha Alyn, Alyn, on YouTube. Tisha, thanks so much for joining us on the NoPo podcast. It was a treat to have you. We admire your Instagram game and more. And hopefully we'll talk to you again in the future. And if you ever make it to the East Coast, as I've promised, I'll take you out for a round of golf. Thanks for joining us. Vera, John, thank you as always. And to our audience, thanks for listening to the NoPo podcast, News Without the Noise. Deep in your-